Prophetically, 4 years ago, something started in this entire area that is bringing together the body of Christ in a revival of reconciliation. It's actually a love revolution. And we're all coming together as one body at One Louisiana. It's one day, one body, one mission. April 29, 2017 at the Southeastern Louisiana University Center to see our region unified by a prayer movement that breaks every barrier that the enemy would love to wedge between us. This will be a gathering to cry out for healing and reconciliation. Our region, our state, our nation, where we take on the vision of Christ for our area and begin to build an atmosphere where heaven truly comes to earth. It's also a time to actually see the body commissioned to bring the kingdom and leave behind religious mindsets, cultural mindsets, so people of every different type of race and religion and ethnic background that are part of the prayer movement are coming together at this one event to unify themselves physically, but also to unify ourselves in one spirit, so that actually on that day we can see miracles, signs, and wonders as we come together to answer the very prayer request of our Lord that we might be one.
And I want to say to all the youth, if you're a youth in here today, I'm talking to you, all of y'all. I would love for see all of y'all's beautiful faces. Well, most of you have beautiful faces. Come on, laugh a little bit. So I'd love to see all of y'all's beautiful faces Wednesday night at the training, and we're going to just empower y'all to go out and change the world. We talk about being world changers, but then we get opportunities to be world changers, and this is a great opportunity. There's something supernatural that we sometimes miss out on because we don't show up for it. Right. Showing up is a big part of the game. Yes. Just show up. What am I supposed to do? Well, show up. You know what showing up is? It's a commitment. Amen. Showing up is a commitment. It's saying, you know what? I'm not just talking about one, I'm talking about life. Just show up. We miss out on a lot of things because we don't show up. We don't show up to it, and I'm talking about spiritual things. We don't show up at prayer meeting. We don't show up in our personal time and our personal devotion. We don't get the word out. We don't show up. And when we don't show up, we miss out on what God's speaking. So the first thing to do is just show up. That's a good word right there. You're dismissed. You can go home. God bless you. But you just need to show up. You need to say, God, I'm here. I'm present. Whatever you want to do with me. It's quiet in here this morning. I'm here, God. Whatever you want to do in my life. I got up this morning, Lord, and I prepared myself for you. I prepared myself that you can do anything in my life today you want to do. You can speak to me, God. You could touch my life. You can use me today, God. You know, we talk about being saved, and I understand I understand what it means to say that I'm saved. But really, honestly, God wants us to be spent. Not burnt out, not without rest, not overworked. But our life, everything that he's given us is to give out. And sometimes we're so saved, we're just saved. And you know, like a sponge. A sponge needs to be wrung out. Because if it just sits on the shelf, two things will happen. One, if it's full of water and it sits on the shelf, it'll rot. And if it never gets dipped in water, it'll dry up and just fall apart. But when a sponge is used and it's put in the water and then it's pulled out of the water and it's wrung out, then it gets to be, it does its job and it continues to live and have life. Now, I'm not talking about one of these little imitation sponges. I'm talking about a real sponge. It has life in it. It has life in the very use of it. You know what? We have life in our use, what God's called us to do. You see, before the world's a frame rusted, he knew you. And he said he called you for this purpose, and he wants to use you in the way that he planned for your life. And so he's already, before you ever existed on this planet. Is that baby awake or asleep? Wait, can I borrow the baby? I promise I'll give it back. I've done my fair share of this. like we see this baby is just so cute. All their babies cry and look at me strange, so he's looking at me like, who are you? But we see this baby, and we just see this cuddly, sweet, little, beautiful baby. God sees all the potential. He sees the purpose. There's already kingdom over this child.
Amen.
Right.
This is not, listen, even in the world where we talk about babies being born illegitimately, God does not have any illegitimate children.
Amen.
Every seed has purpose.
Right.
Come on, somebody. And there's no illegitimate children. And so before the foundation of the world, before he said, let there be, this child right here had destiny in his life. And so then the Lord gives this beautiful baby to two God-fearing parents, and they raise him up in the fear of the Lord and the purpose of the Lord so that they walk in the purpose of the Lord. There's so much potential, but so many times we don't walk in the potential that God has for us because we stay in this place of just wanting to be pampered. Oh, I'm going to preach today.
Amen.
I'm in a mood today because I didn't preach one single note last service. I'm probably not going to preach any of this. We'll have two totally different messages. So we walk in this place of being pampered. Like church, our American church is a pampered church.
Amen.
It's just pampered. And we just love to be pampered in the church. But God wants us to be mature. The Bible says the man put his hand to a plow and turns back, he's not fit for the kingdom of God.
Right.
I'm assuring you that I've never plowed before, and I don't want to plow tomorrow. But I can assure you that putting your hand to a plow is not for that baby to do. That's a man's work. That's a mature work. Don't get offended, ladies. You can plow too. I understand. That's a grown-up work. That's a better way to say that. That's an adult work. And when you put your hands to a plow, there's purpose behind what you're doing. You're preparing the ground for something that's greater than yourself.
Amen.
We've got to get out of our pampered state of presence of mind and realize that everything that God is doing in the earth and his purpose is to use you for something greater than yourself. Anybody here today?
Yes.
Now, Pastor, I didn't come to church today to hear this. I came to church today because I just wanted you to bless me. Well, okay, well, you're blessed. But here's the deal. Your blessing can be your curse. If you only live in that place where I just want to be blessed and you never pour out, you're going to be like that sponge, and all of a sudden your life is going to either dry up or it's going to rot. What's that smell? That smell is the smell of, hey, I'm just all about me. I've come to be pampered. You start spoiling. There's no giving out. So God called us to give out. The reason he filled you with the Spirit of God is not so that you could just exist. Now, I don't know about you, but I've had plenty of opportunities to go to jail in my life and probably even some opportunities to go to hell as well. But God didn't fill us with the Spirit to keep us out of jail and to keep us out of hell.
Amen.
This is not an escape route.
Amen. Amen.
This is not an escape route. This is an opportunity for us to be in a deep river of God, a deep place in the Spirit of God, so that we become affected. The scripture says this in Isaiah, says, out of the house of the Lord, or is it Ezekiel? Anyway, it's in the Bible. Out of the house of the Lord, the river flowed out of the house of God, not into the house of God. In the American church, we want the river to flow into the house of God.
Yeah.
The purpose of the kingdom is to flow out of the house of God. Matter of fact, we like, let it flow, Lord. He's like, yeah, I'm trying to. The water began to rise. It was ankle deep. Then it was knee deep. Then it was waist deep. And it was flowing out of the house of God. And it flew, and it flowed into the tributaries. And it moved into places that were desolate. And when the water begins to flow out of the house of the God, then then there's nourishment, and the things around begin to be nourished, and the trees begin to grow, and the plants begin to grow. And things begin to happen. In the same way in the spirit realm, when the Spirit of God begins to flow out of the house, lives begin to be changed. This is a kingdom principle. The kingdom is that we bring heaven to earth. And it's hard to live from that kingdom principle of bringing heaven to earth as long as, for many of us, because we don't know who we are. We don't know who we are. We don't know who we were created to be. We sometimes live in this place of church being just something that we do, or that escape route to make sure that I get to heaven. And not that that's a bad thing, because nobody wants to go to hell, right? Well, Jason's the only one that don't want to go. Nobody wants to go to hell. But we can't live. Let me tell you something. That's so boring. That's so dry. That, as a matter of fact, that's not really living. When he said, "I come to give you life," somebody shout life.
Life.
But we got to know who we are. We got to know who we are in the kingdom of God, and know that we're not called to be orphans or to be just barely making it in life. But God has called us to be King's kids and to live in this incredible place of abundance, boys. I wish the church would get this. If we would ever get this concept of how amazing God is and how amazing, like, here's the deal. If you have sometimes of our mentality of God, it's really hard to spend time with him, because God is this mystical, far off, away God. But when you understand him as his Father, that changes everything. I'm 53 years old, and I won't hesitate to pick up the phone and call my father or my father-in-law. I know I need them in my life. I know that I need them speaking into my life. So I gain wisdom from that. When we understand Father, our Heavenly Father, in the same manner, we'll spend more time with him and get greater downloads. Anybody here today?
Amen.
He is amazing. In this passage of scripture, it's been burning within me, because I've heard this all my life. You know, I've heard this, the prayer over and over and over again. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Every funeral, some weddings, quoted in church, taught as a kid. But has it really sinked in to who and what we're talking about? My daddy, my father in heaven. Your kingdom is living in me. Therefore, I walk not in slavery, but in sonship. I live above and not beneath. I live in a place of obedience as well as authority.
Yes.
A lot of things that we think about today as authority is not really authority. It's more control, or some of it's really just bullying. Real authority doesn't have to tell you it's in charge. Because what it speaks happens. It's like, bless God, I'm the man of this house, woman. If you got to tell your wife that, you're probably not. I'll let that sink in a minute. Real authority operates out of love. Real authority operates out of doing. Real authority cares more about what's best for someone else than what's best for yourself. Soak. But when you feel like a slave instead of a son, you'll fight back. But when you feel like a son and know who you are, you'll walk in authority. It's kind of like, you don't have to say it, but you know my daddy's bigger than yours. And he'll provide for me everything that I need. Can I talk about that for a minute? Sometimes we spend more time asking God to provide for what we want than what we need. If we position ourselves to say, God, what is best for me? You're my daddy. Give me what's best for me. I think it would change a lot of things in our life. But because we, and look, and I don't say this to be mean, but because we're Americans, we usually pray for stuff. It's out of a place of survival that we're praying for stuff. We're saying, God, 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 help, 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 do. Instead of, God, you know what's best for me. Because a good father would give to his children what's best for them. Anybody here today? Look, I had a whole another message to preach. Maybe I'll preach. I was going to preach on the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I may get around to that in a minute. But the deal is when we walk in this place or this position of knowing who we are, it switches the roles. It switches the things in our life. We no longer live out of this place of survival, but we live out of a place of kingship. Most people that I run into, the most people that I run with, they're not talk to, they're living out of a place of survival. They're just trying to make, Lord, if I can just make it another day. Instead of, Lord, this day is awesome. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for the provision. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings of my life. Thank you, Lord. I'm walking in a place of authority. I'm not walking as a beggar, an orphan. I'm walking in sonship. I'm going to read out of the Passion for just a moment and preach out of this. I've been preaching out of this for several weeks now, so if you've been around, you've heard me talk about this because this is burning in me. Our Father, dwelling in the heavenly realms, may the glory of your name be the center on which our lives turn. Our Father, dwelling in heavenly realms, may the glory of your name be the center on which our lives turn. Let me ask you this question. Don't raise your hand. Don't speak out loud. Just process this. What's the center of your life? What's the hub of your life? What do you spend most of your time dwelling on? Now, I know we have to have jobs, and I know we have to go to work, and I know we have to raise kids, and for all you young moms, you got to change diapers, and you got to make bottles, and for all you parents with teenage kids, you have them driving cars, and you got all of that to deal with, and for life is happening. I get it. But what is the center of your focus of life? Because of all the things that are going on in life are your center, you'll operate, whether you intend to or not, you'll operate out of a place of the flesh, and you will continue to reap the things of the flesh. Let me just say it like this. If my marriage needs help, I better not try to fix it in the flesh because I'm going to reap some more of the flesh. But if my marriage needs help, I need to say, okay, Dad, talk to me. Here's an interesting thing, and the truth of it is, it took me a while to learn this, and sometimes I still forget. Sometimes when the frustration of marriage comes on, I start trying to fix it all. I want to fix the problem. I want to fix the situation. I want to fix this. I want to fix that. And most of the times, I'm looking through the eyes of the flesh when I do it, and I'm really looking at what's wrong with Angela and what's wrong with the kids, because there's nothing wrong with me. What's their problem? I mean, no, you're laughing, but you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because my wife told me the other day, she said, last night, she said, you've been kind of in a weird mood. You know what my response was? No, I haven't. You see, here's the deal. I'm going to help you today if you listen. When we say, God, Father, help me, all of a sudden, what's out of alignment becomes into spiritual alignment, not fleshly alignment. And he brings us into order of his purpose and his kingdom in our life immediately. He is the only one who knows what is in our next. And he is bringing us into alignment with kingdom authority so that we walk in purpose, not just wandering in the dark. Not just trying to fix this life, not just trying to go through the motions, but he's bringing us into alignment. Why? In his alignment, there is provision. Is anybody getting this morning? Or am I just preaching to myself? In his alignment, there is provision. In his provision, there's perfection. In his perfection, he has everything in store. Everything that we need or is that's purposeful in our life, he has it. We don't live out of desperation then. We live out of his provision then. It changes our perspective. So now we live from a heavenly place. So you know what? We're bringing heaven to earth. We're bringing this heavenly realm of heaven. You know, everybody wants to go to heaven, right? Woo, we get to heaven. There's going to be streets of gold and gates of pearl. I remember growing up, we used to sing all them songs. Won't it be wonderful there? Come on, somebody. Having no burdens to bear. I forgot the next words. Joyously singing with something bells all ringing. Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, we used to sing, oh, won't we have a time when we get over yonder? Won't we have a time? Beulah land, I'm longing for you. Come on. And on some day, you know what we're singing? We don't have an understanding of heaven.
Right.
Because God's saying, hey, you can have all that right now.
Amen. Yes.
You're trying to escape. He's trying to feel. Why did he send the Holy Spirit? So heaven could come down.
Amen.
So his glory could rest upon us. So the provision of heaven would come to earth. Oh, somebody ought to get happy right now. Hey, I'm not just trying to, I know we're not, we're just in this place for a short time, but the scripture tells us, I think this is in my notes somewhere. I'm all over the place this morning, but it's okay. The scripture tells us that we're in this world, but we're not of this world. And when he prayed, he did not pray for us to escape this world, but that the Spirit of God would come in us so that we could change the world.
Right.
I'm paraphrasing that.
Right.
He said, I'm not praying that you would leave this world. I'm going away, but I'm leaving you here. I'm filling you with the Holy Spirit so that you can bring heaven's principles, heaven's kingdom, heaven's glory, heaven's provision all to this earth. You're in the world, but you're not of the world. I'm living from a different economy. I'm living from a different place than the rest of the world is living. There's something, there's complete difference in my thought process of how I view life. And that's how God's kids are supposed to operate. Verse 10. Manifest your kingdom realm and cause your very purpose to be fulfilled on this earth, just as you have fulfilled it in heaven. Causes very purpose of heaven to be fulfilled on earth. the way you already have it in heaven. We're bringing heaven to this earth. Amen. Some of y'all looking at me like I've lost my mind. Verse 11, give us this day our daily bread. And he says it in here, give us today the bread of tomorrow. Make the provision. Many of us just worry to death about things that we don't have to worry about. We fear about things. Don't take no thought of tomorrow. Don't worry about tomorrow. Don't worry about all the what's going on. You get so stressed out worrying about tomorrow that you can't even see what's today. But when we walk in this kingdom realm, we live in a place of peace and a place of joy and a place of purpose. You say, Pastor, you live like this all the time? No, because sometimes I get focused on the earthly things. Sometimes my mind and my thoughts get off of heaven, and I get to worry, and I get to thinking, I get to stressing out, and guess what happens? I start trying to fix things. And when I'm done with it, it was a mess. Now it's a big mess. Can I get a better amen?
Amen.
Whatever was a mess is now a big mess. But when I look to him, the author and the finisher of my faith, and I say, God in heaven, let your kingdom come, let your will, let your purpose be done today in this situation, it's remarkable the things that happen.
Right.
And this is the area I'm going to get stuck on just for a few minutes. And I think this is the big problem with many, many people, especially today in our world, in our culture. Now listen, I love counselors, and I don't want you to take what I'm about to say. I believe in counseling. I do believe in counseling. So don't twist what I'm about to say. But we've got a problem. Because we run to counselors, and we run to people, and we say to them, this is my issue, this is what's going on in my life. They drag up of our past and tell us we have a right to be that way. Boy, it's quiet in here this morning. Come on, somebody just say amen for the fun of it. And they drag up all of our hurts and all of our pains, but the problem is they leave us right there. Here's what it says. Forgive us of our wrong we have done, as we ourselves release and forgiveness to those who have wronged us. The enemy will always try to drag you back into the trap, and you got to live in this place of forgiveness, and it has to be an open door. You cannot let wounds, you cannot let hurt, you cannot let those things ever get in your heart. If you don't forgive, let me just read to you from 14. He says, when you pray, make sure you forgive the faults of others so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you. Do it without, but if you withhold forgiveness from others, your Father will withhold forgiveness from you. That's a powerful statement, right? If you withhold forgiveness from others, Father, God's going to hold forgiveness from you. But let's flip that scripture around, because everything has a positive to it. But when you release others and when you pour out your love on others, Father God is going to pour out his Spirit upon you. You're going to walk in places of freedom that you've never walked in. You're going to see things you've never seen. You're going to hear things from God that you've never heard. You're going to walk in authority that you never had. It's supernatural. It's the key that unlocks the very gates of heaven upon you to do see the miracle signs and wonders, and to see the provision of God, and to see the blessings of God. It opens the avenues of heaven over your life. It's probably the most powerful thing in this book. And it's so easy to let offense get in our life. It's so easy to let things come up and rise in our life. And it very shuts down the presence of God in our life. I'm telling you today, I'm so tired of seeing good men and women of God struggle in serving God. And it's simply because they won't forgive.
Amen.
And because somebody's made it okay for them to hold on to their past and to say it's okay to hate those people who've done you wrong. Let me tell you something. The only thing that you're doing is you're poisoning your own self. When you release that, it opens up the windows of heaven and supernatural healing comes in your life. And now you look at Father God from a whole different perspective.
Amen.
Could somebody say amen?
Amen.
Here's the key. The next verse says, rescue us every time we face tribulation and set us free from evil. You know what the devil wants to do? He wants to bring bitterness in between, like, right here. Here's the devil. He don't love you today. She's not telling you the truth. But the devil will embarrass you.
Mm-hmm.
You see, because here the Bible says if two or three agree on any one thing, it shall be done. If one could put 1,000 to flight, two could put 10,000 to flight. Bitterness, hurt, strife separates the power of God in our life. It diminishes. We're praying for unity right now in the body of Christ. You better be careful what you pray for, because the devil will take all the arsenal out and start shooting it at you. That's why Ephesians tells us to put on the whole armor of God, that we may be able to withstand. It's when we break those things off in our life that when tribulation comes, now if the two agree, they're walking as one. As the body of Christ walks as one, we face tribulation from a different perspective.
Yes.
I'm in a hurry because listen, the giant is already defeated. I want you to say that today. The giant is already defeated. All we have to do is walk in authority.
Amen.
David was not, he was a lad. He knew how to be in the presence of God. He knew how to walk in the, he had an encounter, daily encounter with the presence of God. So when he faced the giant, he'd already been up against a lion and a bear. He'd already seen the work of the Lord. His obedience and his understanding of his Father God separated him from the pack.
Yes.
They were all children of Israel, but his intimacy with God made him different than the rest. That moment when everybody else was fearful, David was saying, give me the giant. You're going to face tribulation. You're going to face problems in your life. You're going to face situations. I guarantee you that tomorrow, maybe today, maybe in the next few minutes, you're going to have an opportunity to face something, an offense, a situation, a problem, a bill, an oh no moment. The Bible doesn't say you may be offended. It said offense will come. Somebody say it's coming. How do I handle it? I'm going to face tribulation. It's coming. How do I handle it? When I understand this very principle that kingdom, Father God, is working in my life, his kingdom come. I'm not living from an earthly perspective. I'm living from a heavenly perspective. And his glory. Is anybody here today? is resting upon me. His purpose is resting upon me. There's healing already provided for me. There's miracles already in my midst. I'm not going after a miracle. I'm in a miracle. Because I'm living from a kingdom perspective. He's pouring out his spirit. We're living in a moment where he's pouring out his spirit like never before. I can't remember if it was Thursday or Friday. I'm confused about the day. But I woke up just with this dream or vision. It was kind of in that waking time, so I don't know if I dozed back off to sleep and began to dream this or it was a vision. I told him in first service, it's old men shall dream dreams and young men shall see visions. It was a vision. Definitely a vision. But I was in this moment when I began to see people just being in a crowd of people being filled with the Holy Spirit. And the power of God was just falling like it was on the day of Pentecost. Amen. The power of God was just falling. The presence of God was coming in waves. And people were being filled with the Spirit, just rapidly being filled with the Spirit. Amen. I can't tell you where the room was, can't tell you where the place was, but I woke up with this revival burning in me. Yes. That we're living in a moment when God is wanting to pour out his Spirit like never before. And he's wanting to bring revival to this land like never before. There is a birthing, and there is the reason we're praying it this week, to one, is because there's a birthing that's going on, that God's about to pour out his Spirit like crazy, and we're moving into a revival. But here's the deal. I think this is why God put this so on my heart this morning. But his people have to get healed so they can disciple. The people of God have to be in a position that we're walking in this place of anointing in our lives. And God's calling us out of the spirit of survival into the spirit of revival.
Yes.
Where our hearts burn for the presence of God. Where there's a passion for the presence of God. Where we've moved everything out of our life that's hindered the presence of God. We've moved all of the hurt and all the pain and all the bitterness and all the things. We've said, Lord, we forgive, God. We release that. Now make me a vessel, Lord, that you can just flow through.
Hallelujah.
A river of God. A river of the supernatural, so that we walk into the streets and we lay hands on the sick and we see people recover. We see the blind see, the deaf hear, and the lame walk. You know, when the Spirit of God moved in the day on the book of Acts, the day of the Acts, the Bible says there was a wind, a rushing mighty wind, filled all the house where they're sitting, cloven tongues like a fire set upon their head, and they begin to speak with a new tongue. And studying that scripture out, that talking about that fire, the fire of God, has become like the Holy Spirit, and it leads us. We need to be led by the Spirit. We need to be walking in the Spirit realm and led by the Spirit. It's very difficult for us to be led by the Spirit until we know who our daddy is.
Amen.
But when we know, we're an unstoppable force.
Amen.
And I see the church as an unstoppable force.
Amen.
And I see God pouring out his Spirit like crazy.
Yes.
Everybody say crazy.
Crazy.
Come on. I want you to say it like I saw Lisa say it. Crazy. Crazy revival, a crazy outpouring of the Spirit, a crazy, because we want to just not make it so crazy. Oh, I'm not going to preach on downplaying that right now. We need to make it just like, let it loose. Let heaven come. Let revival come. Let the Spirit of God come. Let the presence of God begin to heal. Let wounds be healed. Let the river of God flow. Come on, God. Crazy. Crazy. So we're shifting. There's a shifting in the Spirit. There's a shifting in the atmosphere. It's not God's will for you to be just simply saved. That's not God's will. How many people are sitting on church pews that are saved, but they're not, they're still in grave clothes? They're out of the tomb, but they're walking around in grave clothes. They're still bound by the past. Well, listen, news break. Jesus didn't take the grave clothes off of them. He turned to the disciples and said, "You take the grave clothes off." God's calling the church to take the grave clothes off and set people free.
Amen.
And when this outpouring of the Holy Spirit comes, and as it's coming, it's not coming, it's here. And as people give their life to Christ by the hundreds and people are filled with the Holy Spirit, it's going to be the church's responsibility to take what the Father has done for us and go take the grave clothes off of those and say, come on, you're free. Go and do what you're called to do. Walk in the Spirit. Live free. Obey what God's called you to do. And I feel a release of that in this place this morning. I know it's Sunday morning, and I really worked hard yesterday to prepare an evangelistic message. I mean, I spent all day preparing an evangelistic message. But the Lord said today, hey, church, I want you to be free.
Yes.
I want you to walk in complete freedom and know who your daddy is.
That's right.
Know who your father is. You're not a slave. You're not an orphan. And he's good. He's a good father.
Yes.
He's a good father. Somebody say, he's a good father.
He's a good father.
Say, my daddy loves me.
My daddy loves
me. I was listening to a young lady on the news. Worship team, you can come. I was listening to a young lady on the news this week, young African-American girl. And you ever watch somebody even on the news, you're like, you know that girl's saved right there. You know what I'm saying? You're watching them, you're thinking, I feel an anointing just coming off the TV. And she was on Fox Business News, and she was talking about all of these lies that has been put on people, just lies. She was denouncing all those lies. That's a lie. That's a lie. That's a lie. That's a lie. She was just really talking about the goodness of God, quite honestly. And at the end of the thing, she said something that just was so powerful. It was one of those moments, I went, go girl, preach that. And she said, in America today, and she rattled off some statistic, how many young people are growing up today fatherless. It's amazing. It's a huge number. And I love what she said, because she said, and she was denouncing another lie. And she said, and this ain't a black thing, this is an American thing.
Amen.
That our generations are growing up without fathers. Here's the deal. The enemy always knows that if we can never understand who our daddy is, he wins. And that's why so much that's been an attack on our society. I'm not going to get into all that deepness today, but I'm just telling you that regardless of what you see around you, you got a father who cares about you.
Yes.
And whatever wounds you've carried from fatherless wounds or abandonment, I pray today you get healed of that so that you can see Daddy God, Father God, as you should see him.
Amen.
And even in homes where the Father's present, so many times the Father's there, but he's not present. But I want you to know today that Daddy God, is present. And that he knows and he cares about every situation in your life. And through all the stuff that you've walked through, all the pain that you've ever walked through, he has never left your side. He's faithful. And he's good. Somebody smile today. Somebody receive the goodness of God today. And that he is so in love with you, and he's so crazy about you. He looks at you today, and his affection for you is so great, you couldn't understand it, no matter how hard you tried. But he wants you to receive it today. He wants you to say, yeah, I believe. Our Father in heaven, in heavenly realms, how would you be your awesome name? Let your kingdom come and invade my life today, God. Let your kingdom come and set me apart, God. I'm no longer a slave. I'm no longer an orphan. I'm a child of God. And I walk in this amazing authority of the Holy Spirit. You've not just come, God, but you said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. But I'm not going to leave you comfortless, and I'm going to put my spirit in you, and I'm going to live in you. I'm going to walk with you every single day. I'm going to wrap my presence around you. I'm going to clothe you with my goodness. I'm going to clothe you with my mercy. I'm going to clothe you with my joy. I'm going to clothe you with my peace. I'm going to clothe you with this abundance of who I am. I'm your daddy, and you're my kid. A long time ago, before I really had a complete understanding of this, I was ministering to someone one day, and I said something, and after I said it, I thought, that sounds so crazy. But now that I understand more about it, it didn't sound so crazy. I said, God just wants you to crawl up in his lap and let him put his arms around you. And I thought, well, that was weird. You know, sometimes you obey the Lord, like, well, that was weird. I'm like, crawl up and, you know why? Because I still had this image of God being go ahead, do something wrong. I dare you. I still had this image of God wanting to penalize and spank and discipline. And God does discipline, don't get me wrong, but it's in love. And so when I said it prophetically that day, it even sounded strange to me. But now that I understand, I just want to say to somebody today, just crawl up in daddy's lap. Amen. And that just let him put his arm around you. Amen. And let him tell you it's going to be all right. Amen. Let him give you what you lack. And let him love you like nobody else can. I see in this room this morning that lives are just being touched right now. God's speaking to somebody in this place today. He's healing some hearts right where we are. And listen, there's nobody. Look, don't feel. Let me denounce another lie. The devil always wants to make us believe that we're the only ones wounded and hurt. I would like for someone in this building right now, you've never been wounded in your life, raise your hand. We've all been wounded. We've all walked through storms. We've all felt at times we were forgotten. If you've been married more than a week, I'm not being funny, but if you've been married more than a week, if you've got kids, if you go to church or to work, if you're around people, if you ever come close to anybody in a work relationship, a church relationship, a marriage, a family, you've got wounds. You have to decide today, am I going to hold on to those things, or I'm going to let go of those things? And I'm going to let God just have free reign in my life. I give it all to Him. I give it all to God. See, what the enemy really would love for you to do I'll use you because I know this don't affect you. Come here. He put you over here in this shame. Put your nose in the corner. Just go over there. Go all the way in the corner. Shame you. Isolate you. You're the only one dealing with life like this. Nobody understands your pain. Nobody understands what you've been through. He'll shame you into the corner. He'll put you in the corner of life, isolated, alone, in the dark. That's a lie. And your father is trying to say, hey, I got more for you. That's not where you belong. That's not your position. Father says, come here. Come here, son. See, it don't matter what the devil said to you when you was a kid. I'm your daddy. I got this throne room. I got this banquet table. I got this place of provision for you. I've got everything that you need. And you know what? You're not living in that place. I got a seat for you at the table. You belong here. This is your spot. Everything that you need, everything that you want, everything, I got it. No guilt, no shame. We denounce all those lies and we say, you're a child of mine. Amen. And I'm proud of you. Amen. You're not perfect, but you're pardoned. I did it all for you. At Calvary. It belongs to you. I'm calling somebody out of the shame and the guilt of their past and the brokenness of their life and the lies of the enemy today. I'm saying to you today, you're a child of the King. You're set free. Let's break it off today. And let's walk in peace. Let's walk in that authority. Let's walk in that provision. Let's walk in that abundance of God. Come on, child of God. You've sat on the church pews long enough. It's time for you to take your place at the table and say, this is what I'm called to do. This is where I belong. This is who I am. I'm going to put on my royal robe. Amen. And I'm going to walk in the purpose in the kingdom of God. Can you bow your heads all over this place today? Bring the lights down, please.